Everybody? All right. If you guys want to find your seats and then stand up, you guys want to hit the lights too, that'd be great. All right. Let's pray, guys. Father, we're so thankful, Lord, to be in your house tonight with your people, Lord. I pray that you'll just bless this time as we praise your name. As we gather around your word, in your name, amen.
Jesus Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this night to be able to come together as a body, Lord, and just lean on one another's shoulders and just bear each other's burdens. I just pray that we would pour out love with every opportunity that we are given, Lord. Let's not take that for granted in a world that needs it more now than ever, Lord. I just pray that we would be willing and able to just share your word and spread it as far as you will allow us to go, Lord. We just thank you for your love and your grace that you pour out to us daily. And I just thank you for this body and this family, Lord. Just love them so much. In your name we pray. Amen.
Greater things have yet to come, greater things still to to be done here. Lord of this nation, you are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. Oh, there is no one like our God. Oh, there is no one like our God. To come, greater things still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things still to be done here.
There's no one like our God.
Father, I just pray that we would help that to be our reminder, God. And every day, I pray that we would just wake up and know that you're the God of this city, the God of this nation, Lord, and the God of this town. I just pray that we would stop walking around in fear and that we would just walk in your strength, your peace, and your triumph, Lord. Just think of everybody who is hurting or sick or just things that are going on, Lord. I pray that you'd be with them, be their strength and their peace. Lord, we just pray that you bless this message, help it to speak to our hearts, and let us apply that to our everyday lives. In your name we pray. Amen. You guys can greet one another.
Well, good evening, everybody. We're going to be in Exodus 30 this evening, so if you want to turn there, before we do that, we should pray again. Continue to pray for Glenn. He is home, and many of you probably have received that report. And if you haven't, and you have any questions, talk to Lorraine. But continue to pray for Glenn. They've got some answers, and hopefully he's on the mend. So please also pray for the Morrison family. Ryan lost his father this week, so be praying for them as he goes through that. I know that he was a very big presence in their life, and so they are hurting. I spoke with him today, and continue to hold them up. So let's pray, and then we will examine Exodus 30. Lord, thank you so much for this time. We bring those before you that are sick in our congregation, those that are at home for whatever reason, Lord. I pray that you would just let them know your presence, let them feel your peace, strengthen them, Lord. I pray, Lord, for those that are here this evening, Lord. I pray for blessing upon the time in your word, and that it would be a blessed time of fellowship now and afterwards. And I ask, Lord, that you would speak to us through your word this evening. It would be very clear. Your word is clear, very concise. Let our minds be ready to receive it, our hearts. And thank you that you have made us alive. We pray your blessing upon this time in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Sorry, guys. You know, as we went through, coming through Exodus, you start to get into the details. Back in Exodus 25, I believe it's 25, you know, some of the dimensions of the altars, altar of incense. We discussed that here in Exodus 30. And I got thinking about, God is very specific about the ingredients to make up the incense. He's very specific in what the elements are, their quantities, and exactly how it is to smell. And I was thinking about, you know, when you were maybe as a kid, there are certain smells that just now, they take you back to when you were a child. I was thinking about a few of those things. You know, one really weird one for me, this isn't going to just be one of those nights where I tell you all these things, but do you remember some of you guys that are, well, I'm 42, so anywhere around that age, do you remember tinsel on Christmas trees? Because the trees were so sparse, right? They're not beautiful like they are now, so you had to kind of fill in the holes. I love tinsel. And there were these little rectangular packages they came in, and it shouldn't have any smell whatsoever, but when I opened that, it was like, it just smelled like Christmas to me. I don't know, it's chemicals or something. But I couldn't wait from year to year when, you know, you'd see the 10, 12 packages my mom would have to buy in order to fill out the Christmas tree. And I just loved getting into them. And maybe it was once they were on the tree and that they were just kind of somewhat burning, or I don't know. But there was something there. There's certain smells now that will take me back to that. You know, or, you know, the way that your grandmother's house smelled, or, you know, for me, any time that we make American chop suey takes me back to my grandmother when she made goulash. And instantly I'm, you know, 7 or 8 years old, and I'm gathered around the table with family. And there are certain smells that are just, it reminds you, it takes you back. You know, racing fuel is one of those things for me. I bought a John Deere mower, used mower, I don't know, I was up on 46, so like 10 years ago. And whoever had it before me had put this racing fuel in. It has a very distinct smell. It smells wonderful. So I mowed my lawn, and I called up my old crew chief, and I said, man, this mow is wonderful. It's just taking me back to when we were racing. I just couldn't wait to mow the lawn again. You know, there's just certain smells that they just take you back. God has a very specific plan here. a very powerful smell that is only to be a reminder and only to be burnt in a specific way to bring people to that reminder of that sweet fellowship with the Lord. He wants it exactly that way, and he doesn't want any copycats. He doesn't want anything to come in and take any of that away from the communion between him and his children, that sweet-smelling aroma. Very specific. You couldn't just take it home. It had to be done a certain way. It was for them, any time that it was burned, it would bring them to the place of, oh, this is communion with God. This is what God has done for me. This means that God is right there ready to be in communion with me, that I have that sweet fellowship with him. There shouldn't be anything else that smells like that. There shouldn't be anything that tries to replace that. There's no, like, equate version of it. You know, it's what it is, and it's to draw you in and remind you of that beautiful relationship with our God. This is the altar, and on that altar burns incense. So in Exodus 30, we begin with the altar of incense. It says in verse 1, you shall make an altar to burn incense on. You shall make it of acacia wood. A cubit shall be its length, a cubit its width. So 18 inches square, it shall be square, and 2 cubits shall be its height, so 3 feet. Its horns shall be of one piece with it. You shall overlay its top, its sides all around, and its horns with pure gold. You shall make for it a molding of gold all around. 2 gold rings you shall make for it under the molding on both its sides. You shall place them on its 2 sides, and they will be holders for the poles with which to bear it. You shall make the poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold, and you shall put it before the veil that is before the ark of the testimony, before the mercy seat that is over the testimony, where I will meet with you. Aaron shall burn it, or burn on it, sweet incense every morning when he tends the lamps. He shall burn incense on it. And when Aaron lights the lamps at twilight, he shall burn incense on it, a perpetual incense before the Lord throughout your generations. You shall not offer strange incense on it, or burnt offering, or a grain offering, nor shall you pour a drink offering on it. And Aaron shall make atonement upon its horns once a year with the blood of the sin offering of atonement. That's a ritual cleansing of it. Once a year he shall make atonement upon it throughout your generations. It is most holy to the Lord. The Lord's taking this very serious. It's very serious that, so serious that he doesn't want anything, again, he doesn't want the off-brand version. It has to be very specific. And nothing else can compare to the incense. You can't offer anything else on it. Just this. So, place in front of the curtain leading to the most holy place. Right? You have, you know, inside that, the Ark of the Testimony. Hebrews 9:3 actually puts the altar of incense in with the Holy of Holies, the most holy place. And I believe the reason that is it points to, or we find it in Leviticus 16, verse 2 and 3, where it speaks of that Day of Atonement. And what would happen would be the priest, the high priest, would take the coals, take a handful, a full measure of incense, and bring it into that holy place. Now, as the smoke rose, as it did what it was supposed to do, it was very much a part of that most holy place. In Leviticus 16, 12, 13, I have it here, so I'll read it to you. Leviticus 16, 12, and 13 says, with his hands full of sweet incense, beaten fine, shall bring it inside the veil. He shall put the incense on the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of incense may cover the mercy seat that is on the testimony, lest he die. Seeing the glory of God would be death. And so that smoke was a covering. Not only was it a sweet smell, but it was a covering. The thing I love about this is, what does the Bible often liken incense to? The prayers of the saints. It also speaks to God's wisdom imparted to us, God's knowledge that is diffused. In 2 Corinthians, we read it last week, or this past Sunday. that the knowledge of the Lord is diffused into this world by us. It is like that incense. So it is pointing to a lot of things, but one of the things it mainly points to is our prayers. Very important that we can come boldly to Him. The veil has been torn forever through Jesus Christ. But I love that the prayers, no matter what, the prayers of the saints, they get there. They get into the most holy of holy places. Aaron was to burn it twice daily. And the smoke of incense made on the Day of Atonement would veil that mercy seat. There's a practical value in it as well. You can imagine with that many sacrifices that there would be a need for some sweet-smelling aromas around. There is the smell of death. Anybody that's taken an animal from the woods knows that very quickly it begins to smell quite foul. And so there is a practical thing here where it kind of counteracts what was going on. Incense refers to the wisdom of God. In 2 Corinthians 2:14, where I just said it points to the knowledge that is diffused by God through us. We are to counteract the smell of death in the world. That's an interesting way of looking at it, but it's biblical. If God is diffusing knowledge in Him into the world through us, then the practical application of having that sweet smell, that wonderful smell, to counteract the death and the decay, we are spiritually doing the same thing. It's a high calling that our lives should be looked at in that way. Every moment of it, not just Sunday and Wednesday, not just on the high points. Every moment of our life reflects something. And for us, we are, because of what God says we are, that vessel by which He diffuses Himself into the world. What a sweet smell and aroma that is where there is death all around. As I said, is symbolic of prayer as well. In Psalm 141, verse 2, it points to that as it says, "Let my prayer be set before you as incense." Now, it goes on to say, "The lifting up of my hands at the evening sacrifice." Remember, that priest bringing in a full measure of incense. We are to bring in our full measure of prayer and concern to God for that sweet-smelling aroma. In the New Testament, Luke 1:10 says, "The whole multitude of people were praying outside at the hour of incense." How wonderful it is that at the hour of incense, those prayers that were going forth are doing exactly what Revelation 5:7 says, what Revelation 8 points to, that is rising up to the Lord, sweet-smelling aroma. You know, the Lord in Revelation 5:8 is the only one. He takes the scroll, and everybody else bows down. The four living creatures, it says, the 24 elders, fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. How beautiful a reminder of how important prayer is. And I'm one that neglects it often. I shouldn't. I mean, I don't want to scare you, like not that often, but I should be coming before the Lord with everything. But sometimes my first thought is to fret, worry, try to figure it out on my own. That is literally what God is saying. I don't want you to offer anything else on this incense, on this altar. Don't try to put anything else on there, like you trying to figure it out yourself, like you trying to figure it out for somebody else. Bring it to the Lord in prayer. Don't offer anything else on it. Don't try to burn anything else on it. It's not going to be accepted. So, prayer is important. And I love that He makes it a place where He meets with us. Here, the altar. Right at the place of meeting. In a continual place of meeting. Day and night. No strange incense, no burnt offering, no grain offering. Nothing can compare. Nothing can take its place. No drink offering. There is not a thing that can be offered in its place. No substitute. There is no substitute for prayer, church. You got to know that. Not good works. Not even good counsel. Even the things that God says that we are to be in his word still cannot replace prayer. No church attendance. I hate when people, somebody asks for prayer online or you hear somebody say, I need prayer, or I'm going through this, and I say, good vibes coming your way, or, you know, good thoughts coming your way. That's foolishness. You're going to offer those up right alongside of prayers, the prayers of the saints? How dare you? I get offended by weird things. Sometimes people are like, why, you didn't get offended by that? Like, no. But then something like that just like boils my blood. Because nothing should compare to the God of all creation and how he has ordained us to communicate with him. You're going to offer good vibes when I'm praying to the one that created you? I don't think so. It doesn't work that way. It's powerful. That's my point. I'm not really mad. Mark 11:24 says it's powerful. It says pray and receive. Pray and believe, right? In accordance with his will. Pray and receive. James 5:16 says confess your sins and pray. Pray for one another that you may be healed. It's powerful. You want healing? Pray. Confess. Seek God. Philippians 4:6. Don't be anxious. I know some of you right now are anxious. Some of you are worried. We ought to pray, says Philippians. We ought to give thanks and let those things be known. Let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God will guard your hearts and mind in Christ Jesus. That's how powerful prayer is, church. That we can pray and have hope to receive that which we are praying for. We can pray and the heartbreak can be mended. We can pray and anxious thoughts go away. Maybe we don't even receive answers. We just receive that peace because we're trusting in him. James 1:5 says, you lack wisdom? Pray. Ask God for it. He'll give it to you liberally. He's not going to withhold it. That's how powerful prayer is. 1 Timothy 2:8. Paul, his desire is that people, men, women, in every place should pray, lifting holy hands without anger or quarreling. Apparently, where Timothy was at, Paul recognized, probably because Timothy was complaining, there's angering, there's quarreling, there's bickering, there's things that aren't conducive to godly love. And he said, well, pray, lift holy hands. That's the only thing that has the ability to stop this. Pray. Make your requests known before God. So, there's the power of prayer. So the altar of incense symbolized a great many things and was very practical. But I believe that tonight we should be reminded of how important it is to not forget to pray, not forget to talk to our dad. And everything that we're worried about or every concern we have, just bring it before him. Verse 11, it says, then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, when you take the census of the children of Israel for their number, then every man shall give a ransom for himself to the Lord when you number them, that there may be no plague among them when you number them. That is what everyone among those who are numbered shall give, half a shekel according to the shekel of the sanctuary. A shekel is 20 gerahs. The half shekel shall be an offering to the Lord. Everyone included among those who are numbered from 20 years old and above shall give an offering to the Lord. The rich shall not give more, and the poor shall not give less than half a shekel. When you give an offering to the Lord to make atonement for yourselves, and you shall take the atonement money of the children of Israel and shall appoint it for the service of the tabernacle of meeting, that it may be a memorial for the children of Israel before the Lord to make atonement for yourselves. So, there's a lot there. But let's discuss it. Why ransom money? It's probably what you're wondering. What's the point? Well, it's important because to take a census would imply that the one taking the census, sometimes your government, right? The government will take a census to know how many Americans there are. Americans, American government. They kind of feel as though they own you. They want to know how many people they own. Israel is not Israel's. Israel is God's. So the ransom money would be taken to make sure that they knew you didn't belong to man. The census wasn't done in accordance with a man wanting to know what it is that he owned. It was so that you remembered who you belonged to. That ransom money would go to God in the service of the tabernacle. Listen, in Numbers, there are at least two situations or circumstances there where there's a census taken. In 2 Samuel, David takes a census, and Israel is plagued. He doesn't do it in this way. There's no ransom money. There's no giving to God. See, God wasn't into people taking this in order for them to receive more information about the people that they were around and somehow develop this ownership mentality of them. It was dangerous. But God permitted it from time to time. But it had to be done a certain way. Men generally count what belongs to them. They have a pretty good understanding of what they own. And this happens at a very young age. I could have named for you each and every one of my Hot Wheels as a kid, and if one was missing, I knew it. I mean, and I had hundreds and hundreds of them, but I knew each and every one. I knew generally where they were at, and when they were missing, there was a problem. It starts at a very young age. I need to know what's mine, and I'm going to keep track of it. I'm going to look at it. It's going to become precious to me. It's dangerous when it comes to God's people. God's saying, no, you don't belong to any man. You don't belong to any government. You belong to me, Israel. You need to make sure that you know that. So when the kings took that census and they didn't consider what God had said was okay to do and how it was to be done, there was a plague to bring them to the point where they said, we offered something strange. We did something that was unacceptable. We put something on the plate that God said, don't ever do that. It's a great reminder. We belong to the Lord. If you're looking at 2 Samuel 24, where David did that, you can read the whole chapter. The rich shall not give more, and the poor shall not give less. That's interesting. So this isn't really pointing to tithes and offering. This isn't love offerings or anything like that. No free will offering. This is pointing to atonement and redemption. This points to being in debt to God, a confession that I owe the one who has saved me. I owe for what you have done for me. The rich and the poor here are equal. It's a beautiful picture. All must come before God and be accepted in the same way. Old Testament. How is it now? New Testament? Where we're living? Same way. The rich, the poor, they have to come before God in the same way through Jesus Christ. Verse 17, it says, where am I at here? Verse 17. All right, good. Then you shall cut the ram. Nope, I'm on 29. That's why it wasn't working. Sorry. 30, here we go. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, you shall also make a laver of bronze, with its base also of bronze, for washing. You shall put it between the tabernacle of meeting and the altar. You shall put water in it, for Aaron and his sons shall wash their hands and their feet in water from it. When they go into the tabernacle of meeting, or when they come near the altar to minister, to burn an offering made by fire to the Lord. They shall wash with water, lest they die. So they shall wash their hands and their feet, lest they die. And it shall be a statute forever to them, to him and his descendants throughout their generations. So this laver or basin set between the bronze altar and the tabernacle or the tent of meeting. Exodus 38:8 sheds a little bit of light on it. It says he made the laver of brass, the base of bronze. From the bronze mirrors, it says this, from the bronze mirrors of the servant women who assembled at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. How beautiful is that? You know what those were for? Those bronze mirrors is like what we do today, right? Go into the bathroom, check the hairdo, make sure, well, not for me. But, you know, they were offering up. And how beautiful is this? That they would give up a measure of vanity for something holy like this. They wouldn't be so concerned with outward appearance, and they would exchange it for the cleansing of the Lord. I love that. We could just pass over that and think, oh, okay, well, great. I'm glad you have the bronze. But where it came from is beautiful, because in Exodus 38:8, it points to the fact that it came from the mirrors that the women had. They were willing to give up this measure of vanity in order to know the cleansing of the Lord. Oh, that we would all be willing to do that. I'm afraid that since the beginning of time, we've all been, or at least generation after generation, has been concerned with outward appearance, and sometimes more so than the inward. And the outward does, it opens doors for you, if we're being honest in this world. But there is nothing that compares to an inward beauty. That lasts. That's the continuation of those doors being open. That the other side of it vanishes, it fades away. But the inward, we ought to place great emphasis upon that, because the Lord does. So here we're hearing of a ritual cleaning and also a physical cleaning for the priest, that they would not be defiled. The altar speaks of salvation, right? Where there was burnt offerings, that altar speaks of salvation through a sin offering. And then the basin speaks of a sanctification. Speaks of what is needful for us. It's progressive. It's continual. Jesus Christ went about cleaning and cleansing people's feet. In John 13:10, you're already clean, he says. Only you must wash your feet. And Jesus went about doing that. It's continual. Is it the physical act that we're talking about, or was Jesus pointing to something different? I believe, honestly, and I think that there's no stretch there, because Ephesians 5:26 tells us, I shared that last week. What does the word do? What did Jesus go about doing? Washing, cleansing. You're already saved, brothers, he's saying. But there's need. There's need to continuously be progressively sanctified, washed. Jesus is the word. And Ephesians 5:26 tells us we are washed by the water of the word. Continuously coming to him. Because, man, the world gets on us. It does. And it doesn't take away our salvation, but it should bring us to the place where we recognize I'm feeling quite unclean. I know that I need to go to the word. I need to go to Jesus, who is the word, and have my feet cleansed, have the world washed off me. Let it be progressive and continual. Jesus set it up that way, pointed to it, and was an example by doing just that in John 13:10. We ought to take these things seriously. In verse 22, it says, moreover, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, also take for yourself quality spices, 500 shekels of liquid myrrh, half as much as sweet smelling cinnamon, 250 shekels, 250 shekels of sweet smelling cane, 500 shekels of cassia, according to the shekel of the sanctuary, a hin of olive oil. And you shall make from these a holy anointing oil. an ointment compounded according to the art of the perfumer. It shall be a holy anointing. With it you shall anoint the tabernacle of meeting and the ark of testimony, the table and all its utensils, the lampstand and its utensils, the altar of incense, the altar of burnt offering with all its utensils, the laver and its base. You shall consecrate them, that they may be most holy. Whatever touches them must be holy. You shall anoint Aaron and his sons and consecrate them, that they may minister to me as priest. And you shall speak to the children of Israel, saying, this shall be a holy anointing oil to me throughout your generations. It shall not be poured on man's flesh, nor shall you make any other like it, according to its composition. It is holy, and it shall be holy to you. Whoever compounds any like it, whoever puts any of it on an outsider, shall be cut off from his people. So, a sacred mixture once again, not to be used for any other purpose than what it is listed as. Nothing similar should be made like it. No knockoffs, no copycats. And as we pointed to, I believe, last week, the oil, how it signifies the Holy Spirit. We are anointed from on high. We are equipped with the Holy Spirit. And nothing should ever be able to operate in its place. Nothing should ever be able to be postured up against it or next to it as some type of a knockoff. A reminder, right? A reminder that the Lord wants it his way. To seek the Lord in his way. To look to his help. A reminder to pray. A reminder to not take it upon yourself to do it your way. To not go a day without seeking him. See, Exodus 30 is wonderful because it's just a reminder. From everything that we've gone down through here, it points to our relationship with Jesus Christ. It points to a God that wants sweet fellowship with us. That has addressed it here in the Old Testament, back at the beginning of mankind. And it has gone through man's rebellion. And has not changed. God still desires sweet fellowship, and it shouldn't look like anything else that this world can offer. What a great reminder we have this evening. We'll close verse 38. The Lord said to Moses, take sweet spices, stacte and onycha and galbanum and pure frankincense with these sweet spices. There shall be equal amounts of each. You shall make of these an incense, compound according to the art of the perfumer, salted, pure, and holy. Now, salted, there's a few different ways of looking at that, but most think that it causes it to burn hotter. You shall beat some of it very fine, put some of it before the testimony in the tabernacle of meeting, where I will meet with you. It shall be most holy to you. But as for the incense which you shall not make any for yourselves according to its composition. It shall be to you holy to the Lord, for the Lord. Whoever makes any like it to smell it, he shall be cut off from his people. God makes it very clear. He's established again with us. He wants it specific. He wants it sacred. He wants it set apart. He desires that in our lives as well. Sacred, specific, with a purpose. Anything else but him and that communion of the prayers of the saints, the communion with God and his children. Anything else in its place is wrong. Anything that is not according to the scripture is missing the mark. It's important, right? We don't necessarily have the laws and the rules and the regulations that they had back here. And I'm thankful for that. But I think to some degree in my life, I can just come before God, right, boldly, which we can, and think, whatever. You know what I'm thinking, Lord. And God does know the groanings of our heart, those that are, unable to be spoken. He knows, but sometimes it's a thin veil between what's really going on in my life. Just, oh, Lord, yep. I got all kinds of other things going on, but yay, I thought of you. Great. And it just seems to be like you can go the complete opposite direction where you have this very specific way that God wants it done. And then because we are living in this grace period, we think, well, I'll just come to him whenever, right? I mean, it's all good. It's all grace. I think that as we go through this, there is a reminder that not only are we to take it serious and to know where our help comes from, but I think we ought to really guard our hearts against just kind of being flippant about it and just chalking everything up that we do wrong to, oh, you know, grace covers. Paul said, don't abuse grace. Don't abuse it. That mercy that's before you, that which God has given you, that has earned something for him. That should have earned our respect. That should have brought us to the place where we are willing to sacrifice our comfort, that we are willing to present ourselves to him wholly. What he has done and the way he has done it, really, it demands our whole life. Not just a part of it. Not just a portion of the week or a portion of our day or just a little bit of our heart and our mind. This is no reprimand. I'm just saying that as we look at this and the specifics of it, don't just write it off as it was a time, but it's no longer important. We need to come before God in the way that he desires to come before us. That we come before him, but we have to really understand that it's because he desires that type of intimate relationship with us, that he loves us that much. My prayer for my own life is that I don't take that lightly anymore, that I don't just put a bunch of other things on that offering, you know, try to burn that, that my prayer, my communion with him is according to what he desires. He desires that with you guys. Each and every one of us. Let it be specific. Let it be sacred. Let it be the most important thing in your life, your communion with the God that saved you. Amen? All right, let's pray. Lord, thank you for this time through your word, and I pray that you would bless and cover our fellowship now. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. God bless you guys.